I served on the search committee. We worked pretty hard to get a new dean that would kind of launch us to another level. And one of my colleagues on that committee is probably one of the most productive researchers in the college. And one of the things he said is, it's kind of scary to have a new dean who's actually a more productive researcher than you are. So with that, Andre, please come.
Thank you, Chad. Good afternoon, everybody. First, I want to say thank you very much to the organizers for giving me this opportunity to come here and meet with you. And I think more important for you to get to know me. So I thought I would share a little bit of information about me and about the college and about our partnership with the Red Raspberry Commission. So I was born and raised in a little place, Halifax, Nova Scotia. If people know where Nova Scotia is, if you go to Maine, keep going north and hang a right, so keep going east. And then by the time you come to the ocean, you've reached Nova Scotia. So whenever people talk about hurricanes coming up the eastern seaboard and hitting the Carolinas and then going out to sea, it usually hits my little province. So I lived through about five hurricanes that have come up through the U.S. and hit Nova Scotia. So what makes Nova Scotia unique is that it's the wild blueberry capital of Canada. It is the apple capital of Canada. A lot of raspberries. The salmon capital of Canada. I could be talking about Washington State, but it's my little province that I was born and raised in. So when I first came to Washington State, I started on June 1st. 4 days later, I was part of the state agricultural tour, and I was learning about all the wonderful things that's grown and produced in the state. It sounded like I was back home. So the move here has been fantastic for myself, fantastic for my family. And just watching Victoria's video and hearing the things that she was mentioning brought back a lot of memories of back home. As I told you, Nova Scotia is the blueberry capital of Canada. And for a long time, I grew up in a community that was established around a lake, and our Baptist church was the center of that community. And every Sunday, I'd hear people call my mom Spilt. My mom wouldn't tell me the reason why, but that was her nickname, Spilt. So there was this mystery around picking blueberries back in the community I grew up in. The elder in the church was the woman who knew the path to take to go to where the blueberries were. And it's about a 45-minute hike through the woods, and if you take the wrong way, you can get lost. But we'd organize this trip, and there'd be probably about 12 or 15 of us, and we'd go with those big white buckets, and we'd come back with them filled. Well, I was old enough now to go on this trip with my mom, and what would happen is my mom, back in when she was younger, used to carry the bucket or volunteer to carry someone else's bucket, and my mom was the tallest woman in our family at 4'11". So some of those bushes get pretty tall, and my mom would trip and fall, and she would spill those big white buckets of all the blueberries. Spilt those buckets, hence the name Spilt. So I have these wonderful memories of growing up in Nova Scotia, where I would have a bowl of blueberries and we would just put milk on it, and we would have that for dessert or have that for breakfast. Blueberry dumplings, blueberry pie, everything blueberries. So I was the kid that went to school with salmon and lobster and beef tongue. And so all the kids now, back then they used to make fun of me because we came from a family that didn't have a whole lot of means. And so you ate what was available. And as Chad said, I came here from Tucson, Arizona, and I was surprised that beef tongue back in Arizona was more expensive than what you would pay for a roast or steak per pound. And we all know how much expensive salmon is and lobster. So it's interesting what was you had to eat to survive growing up has now become a luxury for a lot of people. So growing up in the family I'm an only child. I was raised by a single mom who stressed to me the importance of education. And so I was always told to stay in school and study, use your head, not your fists, and to advance along. My dream was to play professional football. So even though I'm Canadian and I do like hockey, I kept fighting on the ice, but played a lot of football and ended up having a lot of surgeries and pins in my knee. So football was no longer a career option for me. But my cousin played for the Dallas Cowboys, got two Super Bowl rings back in the early 90s. And he used to tell me that I was the lucky one in the family. And at the time, I didn't understand why, but 30 years later, I certainly do now. When I left Nova Scotia, I went to University of Guelph outside of Toronto, one of the top agricultural universities in Canada, where I did my master's and my PhD. And when I finished, I had an opportunity to go to Scotland, go to Moscow, Idaho, or Perth, Western Australia. So I went to Australia. There I studied, my background is microbiology. I worked on dairy cows. And when I went to Australia, I started working on other animals, started working primarily on sheep, and then did a lot of work on kangaroos and tried to modify the microbiome in sheep from using gut microbes from kangaroos. It's interesting that Victoria also mentioned those five research areas and mentioned gut health. So that's been my area of research for the last 20 years, looking at how to improve the microbes in your gastrointestinal tract, which have now been linked to the gut-brain axis. So there's a lot of things that involve your brain, and it stems from the food you eat, which influences the microbes that live in your gastrointestinal tract. So everything is sort of coming around full circle, and it brings back the importance of food, brings back the importance of healthy food and safe food and what you consume. During my time in Australia, I met my best friend. I was fortunate enough to marry her. And we had a girl, a baby daughter. So we moved to the U.S. in 2009. Our daughter was 3 years old. And we were in the, I was at the department chair of animal science at the University of Vermont for 5 years. While we were in Vermont, my daughter had this cute little Australian accent, and she would say, "Dati, can I have a cup of water?" Well, they put her in speech therapy. And I was not happy with that, but my wife, who also has an Australian accent, said the kids are making fun of her and we don't want her to be picked on. So my daughter now sounds more American than I do, because I say oat in a boat and she doesn't. But we were there for 5.5 years. My research then looked at moose and taking microbes from moose and putting them into dairy cows so they produced more milk or healthier milk. And the reason for that is moose are the wild relatives to domesticated ruminants, and they eat a diet which is not as good or as high quality as what dairy cows would eat, and you never really see a malnourished moose. So they have really unique microbes that can break down feed more efficiently than what domesticated animals have. So we were taking microbes that would be found in wild animals and putting them into domesticated animals to watch improvements and to make them more efficient at breaking down feed. So you could feed an animal less and still get the same productivity or get more productivity by continuing what they were feeding them. And we were doing so by not using drugs, chemicals, antibiotics, or anything that consumers may disagree with. Also during my time in Vermont, again, it came up to what Victoria mentioned about, you know, people want real blueberries, not artificial blueberries. And it was the same thing in Vermont, that they won a case against McDonald's for having maple syrup, which was not real maple syrup. And so it was that same sort of mentality, that same, you know, fighting that people want real maple syrup, not artificial maple syrup. So I totally understand the concept and where that is. I was very fortunate to go to the University of Arizona. They took animal science, microbiology, and veterinary science and merged it into a school of biomedical health. And so I became the inaugural director of that school. And we did a lot of work looking at functional foods and healthy foods, One Health. So healthy soils produce healthy plants. Healthy plants are used by produce healthy animals. Healthy animals produce healthy foods as well, and then you have healthy individuals. So healthy environment, healthy soils, plants, animals, and humans. And I think that set me up in a good regard to be fortunate enough to have this position here. It's well known across the U.S., and it may not be well known to the folks here, because it's usually you don't really see what's going on, or it's harder to see the trees through the forest. But certainly across the country, Washington State University and the state of Washington have this enviable position of being one of the top places in the country, if not the world, to do what you do. And this is all the food that you produce. Washington State is number one in so many different areas that you, and most of what you produce or grow gets exported around the country or around the world. So it's really important for us to have safe and healthy products and for food security. Food safety is one of the programs that I brought to the University of Arizona, which is quite interesting now given the outbreaks of food borne outbreaks in romaine lettuce and other crops, most of which are grown in Yuma, Arizona or in California during the winter months. So it's quite important there. And so one of the things I noticed in coming here is that we don't have a very strong or a large food safety program, which is one of the things that I'm interested in growing here and developing here at Washington State University and the state. My comments about this place being enviable, most of the universities around the country do not have the support of the stakeholders that Washington State University has. Or the forward thinking of their stakeholders and the commissions to see the value of research and to stay ahead of the curve of all the things that come at you, whether it be natural resources or environmental or disease or pests or pathogens, and so that you can stay competitive on a global market. So when I got the call that I was offered the position, I felt like I had won the lottery, and 6 months almost on the job, I feel very blessed to have this opportunity to be here, to be the dean of a college of trendsetters and people that are on the cutting edge of research and moving things along. Our college is the number one funded college by the USDA in the country. And just last week, there was a document that was put out by the USDA where they were highlighting the importance of research and safe and healthy foods. And Washington State University was one of the three or four institutions that was highlighted on that national pamphlet that went out. So that was very, very, very good. One of the things I wanted to mention, and I struck on it already, about the relationship between the commissions, our stakeholders, and the university is second to none. It's something that I was aware of when I was in Vermont, something that we talked about in Arizona and how we can get a stronger relationship with our stakeholders there. And I come here and it's just been a wonderful time. It's been very rewarding just be able to meet with people, see their passion, hear their challenges that they have or things that are coming up or how they could be more competitive. And so I've spent a lot of my time so December 1st will make 6 months that I've been on the job, but I spent a lot of my time going around the state and meeting with people and just listening and hearing what their concerns are, what their needs are. And so this stuff resonates with me. I take it back. I talk about it with my associate deans and we look at how we can make things happen or, you know, what areas of research that we can look at investing in. One of the things I've done is I've also listened to the faculty and where their research areas are and what's hot in their area. So I want to be able to support the faculty to remain competitive, not only domestically, but on a global basis. So what's really interesting is I did a sort of back of the envelope calculation. And when I talked to all the different faculties and all the different 12 academic units and even our extension units, people remember what things were like in the good days. And I hear from people that, well, we used to have a third more faculty. We used to have 25% more faculty. When I work that out for all the units I have, I to make the math easier, I'll round up. It comes to about 120 new faculty I would need to hire to get people back to where they remember things were good. Now, what's interesting is that even though we have fewer faculty, we're actually producing. We're publishing more papers, doing more relevant research, and bringing in more grant dollars. But to get everyone back to where they want to be, we're looking at about 120 new faculty. That would cost at least $12 million a year. So that's not a one-off, but that's $12 million of new money every year. And that doesn't account for any cost of living increases or merit increases or anything else. To get all those new faculty to come in as well, you're looking at startup funds. Depending on your discipline, startup funds could be from a couple of thousand dollars to $1.5 million. But even using a conservative amount of, say, $500,000, you're looking at another $60 million in startup funds. And if you spread that over 3 years, you're looking at $20 million a year plus the $12 million you need. So to get everyone back to where they think they need to be, I'm looking at $32 million of new money each year for 3 years, and then $12 million after that to go along. As you know, times are tough, and we don't have all that extra money to be able to provide for everybody. And so this is where having these relationships coming together, where commissions and the university can work together on strategic plans and strategic priorities. And so one of the main ways of doing that is by having these endowments. And so one of the things I really want to do is I really want to thank the Red Raspberry Commission for their gift, their $1.5 million endowment, which will be able to provide us, the university, to leverage those funds from central admin to put towards for a new faculty line. The revenue that's generated off that endowment also provides the new hire with money that they can sort of keep their program going along, that they can also use that money to leverage for extramural support and federal support. Money is tight everywhere. The amount of research dollars that the USDA does put out isn't growing with the need of research that's required. And it used to be, when I was a graduate student and an early faculty member, that about 25% of people that put in grants would get funded. Now it's less than 10%. So even though we are the number one college in the country for getting research dollars, we still have to compete and be very competitive to get that money. And my job as a dean is to ensure that our faculty are very competitive and amongst the best in the world to move forward. So one of the advantages of having this endowed chair is not only do our reputation help us to go out and search for someone, but it's also the prestige of having an endowed chair title as part of your job. One of the things that scientists look forward to, especially in academia, is after they put in a body of work that shows that they have national reputation or international experience, is they're bestowed an endowment title, or an endowed chair or endowed professor. So that's something that a lot of faculty look forward to, and it's considered very prestigious amongst your peers and amongst your colleagues. So being able to work with the Red Raspberry Commission, I've already signed off on all the paperwork that would have the members of the Raspberry Commission be our partners, work with us on the search committee to identify a top talent to bring them here, and also to help work with them to set priorities in research and moving forward. And so having that endowed chair also allows us to get the best of the best to attract them to come here and to be a part of the community here. As mentioned, I started my job on June 1st, and I think the Red Raspberry Field Days was in early July, so I'd only been on the job for about 4 weeks. And I was returning back from Vancouver, British Columbia, and I made my first visit into Linden. And I had my wife and daughter with me. And so we stayed at the inn, which was fantastic. My first meeting in the morning was at the Dutch Mother's restaurant. And my wife and daughter went across the street to the Linden Dutch Bakery and brought a whole bunch of stuff that we were eating along the way to drive back to Pullman. So my wife got all excited knowing that I was going to be here today, gave me a long list of things that she wanted me to pick up, but I told her I won't be back home for another week, so it wouldn't be a good idea. So as a dean, I'm very, very excited to have this opportunity to conduct a new search for a new faculty member for an endowed chair whose research will be based here. If you talk to my counterparts across the country, many of them are closing programs or shutting down programs. So, as I said, I feel very blessed to be in this position where we're growing things, we're building things, we're putting things together. And so it's interesting. I told my wife I was really excited because this will mean more trips to Linden, this part of Washington State, and that we're going to be working closely with the commission, and we're going to be doing all this great work that's going to be here, and this was fantastic. My wife is happy too that WSU will have a stronger footprint in Linden, but her priority is the bakery, and so we'll have to find a way of merging all that together. So, as I said, the college is doing amazing things. The college brings in about 40% of the external funds. And brings up about 40% of budget for the entire university. We have faculty that are recognized around the world. We have faculty that are leaders in their field. We have an incredible extension and outreach program. And we have fabulous and wonderful teachers and instructors. You know, when I was in Vermont, I thought, wow, you know, university spirit is pretty amazing here. And then the reaction around hockey games was pretty cool. Then I went to Arizona and I saw everyone wearing the big block A. And I thought, wow, the community here is really amazing. And then I went to Pullman. Nothing compares. Pullman is an awesome place to be. And, you know, my wife, who's Australian, who, when we moved to the US in 2009, came in as a dependent, and she wasn't allowed to work in the US. And so she spent a lot of time watching Hallmark Channel. So we walk around Pullman and my wife goes, I feel like I'm in a Hallmark movie. So it's pretty cool. So people always ask me, do you like it here? Is everything okay? Are you happy? And I say, you know what? I spent 7 months in a state where the temperature was below 20 degrees. I spent 7 months in a state where the temperature was always above 100 degrees. I think we finally got it right. So I'm delighted to be here. My family is happy to be here. It's interesting, my daughter has no memory of Australia because she was 3 when she left, but her early childhood memories are growing up in Vermont. And so when we talked to her about Daddy was offered this wonderful opportunity to go to Washington State University, her question was, so we're going to move again? Yes, sweetheart. Can we get a house that has grass? Yes. They have water in the rivers? Yes. I can go skiing and skating? Yes. So I told the story before that I really got Daddy of the Year by coming here. So it's a wonderful place to be. I'm very excited to be here. Very glad to work with all of you. Be happy to grow the program, grow other programs in the college, and really be a genuine partner and help our communities, help our producers, help the state to grow, continue to grow and move forward. And for my family, this is a wonderful place to be to raise our daughter. And the people here in the Northwest are fantastic and been very supportive, not just to me, but also to my wife and daughter. So in closing, I just wanna say, excited about this new endowment with the Ritter-Brasbury Commission. Excited about being moving forward and being able to fill that position with a international leader in his or her field that is going to hopefully take the Raspberry and run with it. And I look forward to working with all of you. And this will be a regular stop along my trips around the state. So I just want to say thank you very much for everything. Thank you for all your support, and I value you as a partner. And as a family member. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wright. You'll be available for questions during lunch and around. I just wanted to announce that lunch will be following this particular session, and it's over there. I'll stop here for a moment.
This symbolic check here represents the commitment of the raspberry industry in this state to partner with Washington State University so that our industry will in fact have a real future of competitiveness for many, many years and decades. It is our honor to partner with the university in this new fashion We've never entered into one of these endowments before, and I think it's going to be great. Costly, but we'll make it happen because it relates to the future of our industry here in this community and in this state. So thank you. I've got added confidence that this will go well because we have a great new dean. So thank you, Andre.
Yeah. And then go Cougs too, Mississippi mustache.
Thank you. We can break for lunch and again be back here at 1:30. Thank you.